Bonjour tout le monde. It is always so great to be back in Vancouver. I spent a lot of time here in BC, from summers with my grandparents to paddling along the coast to years as a school teacher here. So being here always feels like coming home. Let me first start by acknowledging that we're on the traditional Coast Salish territory of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. I also want to thank Chief Sparrow, Councillor Williams, and Chief Thomas for the welcome. And thank you, Stephen, for that introduction and for everything you do to make big things happen on climate. Stephen, ton leadership et ta vision nous ont menés ici aujourd'hui. Merci, mon ami. I want to start today with words about Ukraine. People ask me how this will end. And I can tell you, that's not what Ukrainians are asking. They're talking about how this must end. A full withdrawal of Russian troops and peace, democracy, freedom, and sovereignty restored. The people of Ukraine and their president, Volodymyr Zelensky, are showing incredible resolve. They're fighting not just for their country, but for all of us, as they defend democracy against dictatorship. And that's why it's so important that Canada and our allies around the world remain steadfast in our support of Ukraine, with military, economic, and humanitarian aid, by providing safe haven for people fleeing war, as Canadians always do. We must remain resolved to punish this criminal invasion with catastrophic sanctions on Putin and his inner circle to make them pay for as long as it takes. If Putin thinks we don't have the staying power to see this through, he's dead wrong. Yes, there will be challenges, and yes, there will be pain. Yes, many people in democracies like ours will face higher energy and food prices. But others in the world may face outright shortages and famine, while Ukrainians themselves fight for their lives and pay with their lives. Let us remember that. Just yesterday, I spoke once again with President Zelensky. Last week, I was with our allies at the NATO summit. I've taken time at Ukrainian businesses and community gatherings from Toronto to Montreal and later today here in Vancouver. And what I'm hearing everywhere is that Canadians want to do their part. For the coming months, Canada can help put food on the table and keep the lights on. And for the coming years, we can get into high gear to be ready for the future that is upon us. The leaders I spoke with in Europe over the past few weeks are clear. They don't just want to end their dependence on Russian oil and gas. They want to accelerate the energy transformation to clean and green power. And Canadians have a big role in that work. So that's the context of where our world is today. That's the context as I speak to you about fighting climate change, about protecting our planet, and, just as importantly, about securing success for Canadians in the greener future. On n'a pas à choisir entre une économie forte et un environnement sain. C'est ce que j'ai dit il y a 6 ans, lorsque j'étais ici à ce forum. À l'époque, beaucoup de gens, surtout dans cette salle, étaient d'accord. Mais honnêtement, la lutte contre les changements climatiques était encore trop souvent considérée comme une responsabilité sociale seulement. On ne la voyait pas comme un élément central des plans économiques et des plans d'affaires. Aujourd'hui, les choses ont changé. Et si elles ont changé, c'est en grande partie parce qu'on s'est rendu compte que l'action climatique et l'économie vont réellement ensemble. In the last 6 years, Canada has proven to the world that you can take meaningful climate action while building a strong, growing economy, and as always, BC is ahead of the curve. We put a, yeah, you can applaud for BC on that one. We put a price on pollution right across the country and then fought for it all the way to the Supreme Court. The result? Not, as some conservative politicians foretold, the end of the Canadian economy as we know it. In fact, quite the opposite. The price on pollution continues to mean more money in the pockets of Canadians and less pollution in our air. And for businesses, it means it's easier to invest in their own low-carbon future. We pledged to support clean Canadian innovation and then looked to projects that would create good jobs and clean growth in every part of this country. And the numbers speak for themselves. In the last month alone, we announced 2,500 new jobs coming to Windsor thanks to an LGES Stellantis facility to make electric vehicle batteries. Now, even a few years ago, this kind of multi-billion dollar deal would have seemed like a moonshot. Today, it's Canada's new future for workers and a new face for global investors. We've successfully issued Canada's first ever green bonds worth $5 billion, with the private sector snapping up the chance to invest in clean tech in Canada. And we've continued to build on our historic commitment to public transit with hundreds of millions more for projects that will cut pollution, create jobs, and make lives easier. And those are just announcements made in the last month. Tout ça, c'est bien. Mais il faut également prendre des mesures en faveur de l'environnement indépendamment du reste. Pendant qu'on crée des emplois et qu'on remet plus d'argent dans les poches des gens, on protège aussi une superficie de nature plus importante que jamais. Quand on a signé l'accord de Paris il y a 6 ans, environ seulement 1% des zones marines canadiennes étaient protégées. Aujourd'hui, ce sont près de 14% de ces zones qui sont protégées et on a conservé des espaces d'habitat sauvage équivalents à la moitié de la superficie du Manitoba. Let's be clear. You can grow the economy while taking climate action. In fact, as all of you here at Globe have known and led on for over 3 decades, protecting the environment actually unlocks economic opportunity. Of course, there are still those who would take us backward. There are still politicians who insist that climate action should wait for another time, another place. But what other time? If we don't do this now, it'll be too late. And what other place? There is no plan B because there's no planet B. The question is not whether we keep going on climate action. The question is how much more we can do and how quickly. Because if the last 6 years have shown that climate action is the path forward, they've also shown that we must now set our ambition even higher. It cannot be business as usual when devastating floods wash out highways and farms. It cannot be business as usual when communities are destroyed by wildfires. Lives and livelihoods are on the line. Because, let there be no doubt, there is a cost if we do not meet this moment. Regular Canadians will pay the price. Our children will pay the price. And not just the price of crisis, but the price of lost potential, too. This year, global economic activity on clean tech is expected to be in the trillions. Not millions, not billions, trillions. Les concurrents du Canada sont en train de passer à l'action. En fait, comme l'ont dit nos alliés européens, l'invasion illégale de l'Ukraine par Poutine ne fait qu'accélérer leur recherche d'énergie renouvelable. Le monde prend le virage propre. Le Canada ne peut pas se permettre de passer à côté. On doit saisir cette occasion pour un air pur, pour une économie forte. Et c'est de ça qu'on va parler aujourd'hui. Ce matin, notre gouvernement dévoile le plan de réduction des émissions du Canada, notre plan le plus puissant et détaillé à ce jour. C'est un plan ambitieux et responsable. Ce plan historique va nous permettre de réduire nos émissions de 40 % d'ici 2030 par rapport au niveau de 2005 et de réaliser nos objectifs de neutralité carbone d'ici 2050. On va y parvenir en procédant secteur par secteur, en réduisant les émissions et en multipliant les perspectives dans l'ensemble du pays et de l'économie. This morning, our government is releasing Canada's emissions reduction plan. This is our boldest and most specific step yet. It's ambitious and it's achievable. It's ambitious because it will get us to 40% lower emissions by 2030 compared to 2005 and keep us on track to net zero by 2050. It's achievable because it goes sector by sector, cutting emissions and creating opportunity across the country and the economy. So let's start with what sectors put the most emissions in our air: oil and gas, and transportation. This plan will set a clear, projected contribution on emissions reductions from the oil and gas sector, down by a little over 30% from 2005 levels and a little over 40% relative to current levels. We're laying down a clear, reasonable contribution for the sector to make so we can drive work forward on our commitment to cap and cut emissions. If there's any oil and gas sector in the world that can do it, it's Canada. And if there's any workforce in the world that can drive this shift, it's Canadians. En matière d'innovation propre, on est déjà passé par là. Il suffit de penser à l'aluminium et à l'acier. À une certaine époque, le monde pensait qu'il était impossible de produire de l'aluminium sans produire du même coup d'importantes quantités de pollution. Mais, depuis des années, le Canada produisait déjà de l'aluminium plus propre. Puis, le projet Hélicis a vu le jour au Québec. Ce projet a donné naissance au tout premier procédé au monde pour la production sans carbone de l'aluminium, tout en créant des emplois. À une certaine époque, le monde pensait qu'acier rimait avec cheminée géante. Mais maintenant, en Ontario, Defasco et Algoma abandonnent leur processus de fabrication de l'acier à base de charbon pour des fours électriques à arc. Ces fours sont alimentés par des énergies renouvelables comme l'hydroélectricité. En plus d'être vert, ce changement va faire accroître la compétitivité de l'acier canadien sur le marché mondial, tout en assurant un avenir prometteur aux travailleurs et à leurs familles. I have confidence in Canadian industry, in Canadian workers, and in the Canada we can build together. That goes for oil and gas as much as for any other sector. Canadian workers and engineers are the best in the world. And when it comes to a day on the job, a hydrogen production facility using carbon capture won't look very different than work at a refinery. The commitment is there. Industries are already pushing forward on their own. And yes, the money is there too. with record profits, this is the moment for the oil and gas sector to invest in the sustainable future that will be good for business, good for communities, and good for our future. Big oil lobbyists have had their time on the field. Now it's over to the workers and engineers who will build solutions for their sector, for their communities, and for their kids. Évidemment, si on aspire à un avenir industriel propre, on doit aussi avoir pour but de conduire des véhicules propres. La demande est là, partout dans le monde. D'ailleurs, à chaque semaine, il se vend maintenant autant de véhicules électriques que le total des ventes pendant toute l'année 2012. Notre gouvernement a déjà investi dans le secteur de la fabrication au Canada. Je pense notamment à l'usine Ford à Oakville, qui crée des emplois, ainsi que la nouvelle installation de fabrication de batteries à Bécancour. Notre gouvernement investit aussi dans la vie quotidienne des gens. On installe des bornes de rechange et on a mis sur pied un programme incitatif afin de rendre les véhicules électriques plus abordables pour la classe moyenne. Et on fixe maintenant un objectif de vente obligatoire encore plus ambitieux pour les véhicules électriques. This emissions reduction plan lays out a new mandatory sales target for electric vehicles, at least 20% of all new personal vehicles sold in Canada will be zero emission by 2026. Because if you want to make the switch and you go to the dealership, you shouldn't have to be on a wait list. By 2030, at least 60% of all new personal cars sold will be ZEVs, and by 2035, every single new personal car sold in Canada will be zero emissions. Now, so far, I've talked about cutting emissions, because that's what we need to do to fight climate change. And cutting pollution matters. But so does creating opportunity. Everyone deserves a great career, where they feel proud of their work and where they can provide for their family. Here in BC, you show the way forward with job-creating projects like the plant down the road in Richmond. They use carbon capture to keep emissions out of the air and store them in cement permanently. This plan will build on momentum like that to create good middle-class jobs right across the country. And in places where the changing global market means changes to the local economy, we'll have people's backs. We're committed to creating a new Futures Fund for Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Newfoundland and Labrador to ensure no one is left behind. When Amazon invested $700 million in a solar farm in Alberta, they chose Alberta specifically because of access to renewable energy. When the industry association representing offshore oil and gas in Newfoundland and Labrador announced this month a shift to include renewables, they did it because they know there's room to grow. Industry believes in these communities, and as a government, we do too. In fact, we've already seen how our investments deliver results. I think of the first ever geothermal power facility we're supporting in Saskatchewan, a project that will create jobs while powering homes with clean energy. For so many more communities, this is the bright future we can and we will build by working together. Now, this is just a fraction of what's in the plan. I could talk about our commitment to protect old growth forests, or to expand our investments in clean energy projects with Indigenous communities. But here's the bottom line. This plan isn't just a plan to protect against climate change. It's a plan to build a better future. And it means real results for real people right now. clean air for our kids, and healthy lakes and forests for generations to come. Affordable electric vehicles in driveways and lower monthly heating bills for families. Good jobs for workers and a strong economy for everyone. De l'air pur, des factures mensuelles réduites, des bons emplois pour la classe moyenne, une économie forte pour les générations à venir. C'est ça nos objectifs. C'est ça l'avenir que notre plan va nous aider à bâtir. I started my speech today by talking about the war in Ukraine. I know some people will say a war is no time for climate action, for looking to clean solutions to build a competitive economy. Well, the same people said the pandemic was no time for climate action. We didn't let them stop us then, either. Responsible leadership demanded that we tackle the crisis at hand and build for the future. So to those people, I say this. This is no time for excuses. It is the time for even bolder climate action, because it is always the right time to face a crisis head on. It is always the right time to have workers' backs, and it is always the right time to build a good future for all Canadians. On n'a pas à choisir entre la croissance économique et la santé de l'environnement. On n'a pas à choisir entre des objectifs ambitieux et des objectifs réalisables. Si on travaille ensemble, on va continuer de bâtir un avenir prometteur pour tout le monde. When you walk out of this room, you walk out to be inspired by the gorgeous mountains of the North Shore. And right across the country, Canada's geography inspires and humbles us all. It humbles us because we can't help but feel how much bigger it is than any one of us. But it inspires us because it reminds us that we are the stewards that will ensure it remains for future generations. That is our shared responsibility. That is the challenge before us, and that is the challenge I know we will rise to meet. Merci beaucoup, mes amis.